And now our two chefs will compete, making dishes using only their surprise spiritual fruits.
Are you kidding me?
Hi, I'm Nick.
And I'm Gabby. Welcome to Catholic Central. The fruits of the Spirit. What are they? What do they look like in everyday life? And are they as delicious as they sound?
Well, for starters, these are different than the gifts of the Holy Spirit, which are permanent dispositions that help us listen to what the Holy Spirit is telling us and are strengthened in confirmation.
The fruits of the Spirit are perfections that the Holy Spirit forms in us as the first fruits of eternal glory. Perfections to become invincible.
More like signs that we're on the right track.
No. Those two. They're concrete things that we can observe in ourselves and others when we choose the good.
In Galatians 5, 22 and 23, they're listed out in contrast to the works of the flesh, which can also be pretty good signs that something's off. So first, I'd love to kick us off.
Excuse me? Have you no decency? A tank top? In public? Everyone who looks at you is going to suffer for all eternity and it's going to be your fault! I can see your shoulders! I speak out of love!
Whoa. If your version of love is looking more like anger or hatred, it's probably not real love.
But it is more than a warm, fuzzy feeling.
Catholics believe that love calls us to action, compromise, and self-sacrifice.
Second is joy.
Easy. I'm so joyful. I've gotten everything I've ever wanted. Not stressed out at all. Never felt sad for the guests I paid $400 each for that decided not to show up at the last minute. So blessed. Most joyful day of my life.
Hold on. Joy is not pretending to be happy.
Catholics believe that joy comes from knowing God is always with us.
It's lasting, even when we feel sad, lonely, or angry.
If feeling joy is hard for us, we can pray along with the psalmist in Psalm 94.
When I say, my foot is slipping, your mercy, Lord, holds me up. When cares increase within me, your comfort gives me joy.
Third is peace.
Oh, I know all about peace, man. Anytime anybody's got something to say, I just run away until every person, building, and landmark is totally unfamiliar to me. Just keep running.
Peace is more than just avoiding conflict. It's about trying our best to work through disagreements and refraining from passive-aggressive comments, unlike someone.
Stay strong, Gabby. It's a great goal to have peace with other people in our lives. But what about within?
You can let it out now.
Thank you.
Okay. After all, the Bible does tell us to have no anxiety at all. But how? I mean, I'm anxious about at least 467 things before my feet even hit the floor in the morning.
Well, the Hebrew word for peace, shalom, means to be whole or complete.
God's peace grows in us when we
Fourth is my least favorite fruit to put into practice, patience.
Especially when we're talking patience with God. Like for my friend who is really ready to not have roommates anymore, but has filled out like 45,000 job applications and can't get an interview anywhere. And then last night, her roommate was up until 3 a.m. singing Icelandic funeral dirges.
Patience helps us to see trials as temporary. The book of James says, "See how the farmer waits for the precious fruits of the earth, being patient with it until it receives the early and late rains. You too must be patient. Your friend is gonna be okay."
Well, that's very kind of you to say, which brings us to the fifth fruit, kindness.
Jesus describes God's kindness in the Gospel of Luke, "But rather, love your enemies and do good to them and lend expecting nothing back. For he himself is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked."
We can imitate God's kindness by putting others' needs before our own, or choosing not to pursue vindictiveness.
Which is why I had to finally give up my vigilante lifestyle.
Goodness!
The word for our sixth fruit, goodness, in Greek is Gotham City. I mean, agathosune, meaning an uprightness of heart and life.
Something this city doesn't have anymore.
Are you-
Villains are on the loose. Justice is not served. I am vengeance.
Oh, wow, sorry.
This obviously isn't goodness for the sake of being virtuous.
Hey everyone, did you catch how good of a person I am? Started my own charity with my own money, got my picture in the paper and everything showing how good I am. Just a really good guy.
But solely for the sake of others.
It energizes us to do good, even to our enemies and those who hate us, as Jesus commands in Luke 6:27.
Moving on to our seventh fruit, generosity.
We are more than willing to offer you our generosity in your time of need. With 30% interest that accrues every hour. And if you miss a payment, you owe us a kidney and a child. It doesn't have to be yours. Any kid will do.
True generosity does not expect to be repaid and doesn't give begrudgingly.
Generosity helps us recognize that everything we have is from God, so we can give without fear of running out.
As St. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians, God loves a cheerful giver. Moreover, God is able to make every grace abundant for you, so that in all things, always having all you need, you may have an abundance for every good work.
Moving on to the thing you love most about your favorite fabric softener, gentleness. Also our eighth fruit. It helps us in situations where we need to confront others, or where we might be tempted to, well...
Jesus describes himself as gentle and lowly in heart, so we can use him as our model. On to our ninth fruit, faithfulness.
Faithfulness involves trusting in God and being loyal to him.
But it can be hard. Even throughout the Bible, people struggle with staying in God's corner.
When nothing around us makes sense and we're having a hard time hearing God or understanding what he wants us to do, staying faithful ultimately brings us closer to God.
One thing that can help cultivate faithfulness is looking back at when you faced adversity and noticing how God supported you and brought you through it.
Number 10 is modesty.
I can see your shoulders!
Actually, in the Bible, modesty didn't refer to dress at all, but displays of wealth.
Modesty means living in humility.
Jesus tells us that whoever exalts himself will be humbled, but whoever humbles himself will be exalted.
Okay, I admit that I am nothing. I'm hopeless. Not fit to even say hello to those around me because any interaction with them might ruin their day.
Whoa, hold on there. Humility does not mean hating ourselves.
It's more seeing ourselves honestly and recognizing that we're not in control.
Excellent segue to when we are in control, number 11, self-control.
Oh, I do high impact workouts until my skin hurts and occasionally treat myself to a sugar-free protein bar. I'm so hungry.
Okay, so we don't need to go to extremes, but according to St. Paul, we can learn from athletes.
He writes in 1 Corinthians that athletes exercise self-control to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. Athletes have so much discipline for temporary things, like medals you can't even sell on the black market. Not that I've tried.
It sounds like you've tried.
I tried once and I couldn't do it, so.
Yeah, okay. And Catholics believe that God is there to help us in all our trials. On to the 12th fruit of the Spirit and my favorite medieval belt, chastity!
No, Deb. We've talked a lot about chastity here on Catholic Central and what it isn't.
The ultimate aim of chastity is freedom from feeling controlled by our desires, as well as respecting ourselves and those around us.
It reminds us that our ultimate goal is to love God, so loving others should be in line with that.
Well, I hope this episode has been fruitful.
Let us know in the comments about the fruits you see in your life.
Sweet. For Catholic Central, I'm Nick.
And I'm Gabby. Thanks for watching.